Good morning. Happy Wednesday. For some reason, I feel like someone's looking over my shoulder today. I'm not exactly sure why, but that's okay. I need someone to look out for me, so that's good. That's good. My devotion this morning includes about three scriptures, but first this. I have a strange idea about the second coming of Christ. And if you're a believer and you believe that what the Bible says, you know that Jesus is coming back again. If you're not a believer, you probably doubt that. You might even wonder if he came the first time, but I've done some reading on that. It's interesting. But when it comes to the second coming, I have an interesting theory. My theory is that everyone is wrong. Everyone. Whether it's the postmillennialist, the dispensational premillennialist, or the historical premillennialist, or the amillennialists. And I suppose there are many non-millennialists or pan-millennialists or who knows what else. We get too witty by half sometimes, but here's my theory. At every point in church history, there has been different ways of looking at most of the components of the second coming. For example, before 1948, when Israel was not yet a nation again, Israel didn't seem to factor in quite as much or in the same way into people's thinking as it has in more recent years. Back in the late 60s and early 70s, when there were wars in Israel, I have friends who dove under tables to pray because they believed that Jesus would come at any moment and or that great persecution was coming. You have people like Hal Lindsey that's written books about it. He said that Jesus had to come back. In the first generation of Israel being back in their nation, that would be by 1988. He believed the tribulation would be first, and so it had to be started by 1981. And there has been tribulation, but not to the extent that we would expect right before the coming of Christ. How do I stand on that biblically? Well, part of my Bible stand on that is that the first coming of Jesus, nobody got it right. Nobody. The religious leaders of Jesus' day, the experts in the law, and those most knowledgeable of Scripture, they looked at the Messiah and the passages about the coming Messiah as two parts. One was he would be a suffering servant, and the other is that he would be a conquering king. And so what they determined around the time that Jesus was born and that part of Jewish history was that they themselves were the suffering servants and that the Messiah would be the conquering king who would come and deliver them from the Romans and from other oppressors. They didn't seem to realize that the greatest oppression they had was sin. And part of that sin was their own arrogance and their own self-righteousness. And so they got it wrong. And they understood some things. When the Magi went to Herod and said, where is the Messiah going to be born? His people said, well, Micah says that it's going to be in Bethlehem. And so they sent them to Bethlehem where they found the Christ child. Of course, you look what a religious guy, what a spiritual guy Herod was, that sometime later he had them followed, at least down the path toward Bethlehem, and put a bunch of the babies to death, trying to kill this Christ child. You know, they knew where he was going to be born, but they handled the information very, very wrongly. So, our scriptures this morning are Hosea 11:1, where the scripture says, and I will call my son out of Egypt, and Isaiah 11:1, that says that Jesus will be a Nazarene. And by the way, if you look at that passage, it doesn't say Nazarene. It says something about the branch. And the word branch in Hebrew is Nazer. And so it's interpreted in the New Testament that he would be called a Nazarene. And I mean, that even confuses some of Jesus' followers. At least one of them says, can anything good come out of Nazareth? Well, he was probably talking about scripturally. You know, there was no promise about Nazareth unless you looked accurately at some. And by the way, look up the word branch in the Old Testament. There are quite a number of other references to the branch once you see that that's what it may be talking about. And then Micah 5:2 is our third one. And Micah 5:2 says, "But you, Bethlehem Ephrathah, though you are small among the clans of Judah, out of you will come for me one who will be ruler over Israel, whose origins are from of old, from ancient times." And as I said, they got that one right. But look at what we're seeing here. "I will call my son out of Egypt. He will be called a Nazarene. He'll be born in Bethlehem." How can all that be true at once? Maybe God had something to do with this, because Jesus was born in Bethlehem. And because of Herod, he ended up in Egypt. You know, Joseph took the family to Egypt, but they went back to Nazareth. And so all three are true of in Jesus. The prophecies are all fulfilled. Now, let's go to Micah. Micah is a book that we don't look at very often, but there's a lot of reference in Micah to oppression. The wealthy, the powerful, abusing widows, the poor, anybody that they can abuse. And they use their financial system, they use the law, they use everything they could get in their hands to abuse people. And by the banking system, I mean that you know, if somebody couldn't pay the rent or couldn't pay the mortgage, they booted them out and took their land. Even if they had a crop in the field waiting to harvest and they could have paid whatever it was, any opportunity they had to mistreat people, they did. That's not really a commentary on today, although I guess it is in a way, because there are a lot of times that people can be more merciful. But to me, what Micah is talking about more than person to person is the way that people needed to look to the Lord. People needed to look to him and be able to see the help that he was going to give and that he has given. When I look at Micah, I see verses that remind us about how we're supposed to live. For example, Micah 6:8 is an amazing passage. I keep a kind of a poster on my wall here in my office about this verse. But Micah 6:8 says, "He has showed you, O man, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you but to act justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God." Okay, so act justly, to be just, be fair, be honest, you know, treat people the right way, to love mercy, to go a little bit farther than that, act with love toward them and compassion, and to walk humbly. So we're not being arrogant, we're not being self-centered or self-protective or whatever word you want to use, but to have justice, mercy, and humility is huge. Then I go down to the next chapter in Micah. Micah 7:7 says, "But as for me, I watch in hope for the Lord. I wait for God, my Savior. My God will hear me." What confidence they had in hard times. And Micah was about the same time as Isaiah. And Isaiah has a lot of the same messages about how important it is to be right with God and to be fair with others and treat them right. But the way Micah speaks about his hope that he was going to have, how could he have hope? What was there to give him hope? Well, how about, "But you, Bethlehem Ephrathah, though you are small among the clans of Judah, out of you will come for me one who will be ruler over Israel, whose origins are from old, from ancient times." In other words, God is there. God is with them. God is providing the solution. The baby is going to be born in Bethlehem. Of course, flee to Egypt, grow up in Nazareth, going to go to Jerusalem, carry a cross, die for us. The very end of Micah, verses 7, or chapter 7, verses 18 through 20. "But who is a God like you who pardons sin and forgives the transgression of the remnant of his inheritance? You do not stay angry forever, but delight to show mercy. You will again have compassion on us. You will tread our sins underfoot and hurl all our iniquities into the depths of the sea. You will be true to Jacob and show mercy to Abraham. You pledged on oath to our fathers in days long ago." We come in the faith of Abraham. We come as the spiritual Israel. We come as those who have been pardoned from our sin. Our transgressions have been forgiven, thrown into the depths of the sea because of Jesus. God knew what he was going to do, and he did it. Father, thank you for Christmas. Thank you for the reminder about Jesus. Thank you for the opportunity to put Jesus in the center of our lives so that we can deal with the horrible things around us and this hectic pace of life. I ask, Father, that you would help us to act justly, to love mercy, to walk humbly with you. I ask, Father, that you would help us to put our hope in you, because at the right time, Jesus is coming back, or we are going to him. We want to be with you for eternity through him. Thank you, Father, for being with us. Help us, Father, through this season and the rest of this year. Help us to walk with you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Have a great day.